Thank you very much. And thank you for coming to our concert conversations this evening with the Oregon Symphony Orchestra. I'm John Pitman. I'm the music director at Portland's All Classical 89.9. Do we have some fans of All Classical with us tonight? Yeah. Also had something else that was occurring to me as I was walking to the hall tonight. I'm rubbing my knee because I just banged into the lighting back there. I don't know, not watching where I'm going. But I'm curious to know if there's anybody here attending this talk tonight who has never been at one of our talks. Do we have a few first-timers? A few, but most
welcome.
Of you... most of you are veterans of this event. Okay, great. Well, tonight we're going to be talking about the music that's on the program that includes César Franck on the second half, Shostakovich, never before played by the Oregon Symphony, and a lively Berlioz Overture to open. And to conduct all of this is our guest conductor tonight, Eugene Tzigane. Let's please welcome him.
Good evening.
Gene was with me on All Classical just the other night on Northwest Previews, and we talked about, of course, the music that's going to be on the program, which is what we'll do tonight. But also, I had a chance to learn a little bit about you and your background in conducting up to this point. But I was wondering if maybe I could retread that territory one more time with you, with this audience.
Absolutely, sure.
You are in your third season as conductor of the Nordwestdeutsche Philharmonie in Herford, which is up in the northwest part of Germany.
Yeah, gut.
Yeah, but I'd like to know how you got into that post.
Well, it was very fortunate. I actually did a competition in Frankfurt am Main. Actually, they call it Manhattan because it kind of looks like Manhattan, the skyline. Anyways, when I did the competition, I won second prize, and a number of artistic directors came and immediately invited me to come do concerts. And one of the concerts was with the Nordwestdeutsche Philharmonie. And it was one of those kind of kismet moments where stepped in front of the orchestra and just everything clicked. And within, I would say, 4 days of starting work with them, they already offered me the position. So it was just a wonderful experience. It was kind of love at first work. And it was a wonderful thing.
But you live in New York, so you're a commuting conductor. And you've also recently done just finished several concerts here in the States. You're kind of bouncing back and forth a little bit.
Lots of jet lag.
Yeah. Out here in Portland and then flying back east again one more
yes,
time.
Yes, I go back to New York for one day and then I've earned my vacation, actually.
So, want Portland first impressions. Let's start with notable meals or restaurants.
Notable meals. Actually, you know, I just went to this One Penny Diner. Do you know it? It's right next to the Imperial. It's a brand new. It just opened on Friday, and I had no idea. I just walked in, and they're like, oh, we're doing our soft opening. I was like, wow, is this like a Vegas casino? So, but try it out. It's very kind of hipster, but great food. And then Imperial, of course, itself is fabulous. In terms of first impressions, I'm actually was raised in Northern California, so I'm a West Coast boy, and just coming to Portland, I almost said coming back because it feels so familiar, you know. I love just how lush it is and how the city is so, the nature is just imbued throughout the entire place, and you just feel so comfortable here, and I love that. I even went hiking on one of my days off. Actually, right after the interview we had, I went hiking on one of the two sunny days that we've had this week. I've been really lucky, actually. I think the odds were against me, so I got lucky.
Gene, you have an American father and a Japanese mother, and you were telling me backstage that you managed to find some time to head up to the Japanese garden as well.
Yeah, it was beautiful. Of course, it was like I went to the garden, and then afterwards I did a little hike. And we also have a lovely Japanese tea garden in San Francisco in Golden Gate Park, so I was like, ah, I know exactly where I am.
Okay, one more non-musical question, at least not concert-related question, but you have another Oregon connection, which is through James DePriest, the former director of the Oregon Symphony Orchestra. You took conducting classes with him at Juilliard.
I did.
Now, that doesn't mean This is a baton, Gene.
Not at all.
You were already well past that point.
Oh, he demanded it.
What was he like?
What was he like? He was my Buddhist conducting guru. The first year I was there, actually, I was expecting to learn or to be taught, to be given all this knowledge of conducting. And so it was very kind of, actually, I thought it was frustrating because I didn't know any better. And I kept on asking all these questions. Well, how do you do this? If you want to get this effect from the orchestra, do you show it this way? His answer was just make it work. Make it work. And that was kind of frustrating at first because I thought, well, I want to know what he thinks about these things. But in the end, he said, you know, Gene, the problem is if I give you advice about this, then you won't think about it. And one day you're going to have to conduct this repertoire in front of, oh, say, the Helsinki Philharmonic. Where am I going to be? I won't be there. You have to figure these things out on your own. And so by the end of the first year, it was just kind of a crash course in self-learning, which is, of course, how you learn for the rest of your life. So it was really wonderful. And actually, because he pushed us all to be completely autonomous, none of the students were alike. And I had four wonderful conducting colleagues, which I can't always say. But they were really fantastic, and I could watch them and learn from them. And none of us were alike. We didn't look alike, we didn't conduct alike, we didn't sound alike, nothing resembling that we had the same teacher. You'd never know. So it was really interesting. And he had this ability, and I say Buddhist guru, because he had this ability to give you like one kernel of information that seemingly means nothing. For example, I told you this one, I think. There's only one place that note can be. Really? One place? I think it could be anywhere. But then after about 6 months of wondering, well, what the heck does that mean? What he actually means by that comment is that if you're going throughout, let's say you're driving and you're taking a turn. If you take the turn and you just follow the natural trajectory of the momentum, then you're going to arrive naturally at a certain place. And that's what he meant. Like, if you're going to take a phrase and you slow down, and you let it slow down just organically, then there's only one place a certain note will be, because that's just the natural. You throw a ball, and it's going to land in a predictable place. You know, if there's wind and things like that, you have to calculate. I'm not a physicist, or anything of that nature. But that's what he meant. And it took me 6 months to figure that out. But that's the type of thing that he would tell you. Anyways, I'm talking too much, I'm sorry.
Well, you're going to have to talk a little bit more, and that is about the Berlioz, and Berlioz has lots of notes that have to be only in one spot, and yet, listening to the Berlioz overture, Beatrice Benedict, ideas are flowing all over the place in this particular overture. Let's talk a little bit about Berlioz, the man, first, just to kind of set the scene, because we're listening to a late overture of his, but Hector Berlioz was a wild guy as a younger guy. Many have heard the Symphonie Fantastique, and that has semi-autobiographical aspects to it, with the exception of the part of his story in the symphony where he's murdered his beloved. That didn't really happen. But there was a later instance where he heard that another woman he was in love with was going to marry another man, and in a wild, homicidal moment, he decided he was going to try to kill them.
But he didn't.
He didn't. No, he arrived in Nice, and then it was such a beautiful city, he just forgot all about it. And years later, he just laughed it off. But this is the kind of man we're dealing with this Berlioz overture tonight.
Actually, it's a really wonderful piece that's not played nearly as much as it should be, probably because it doesn't have so much percussion and loud things happening, but actually it's a great piece. Part of the reason why I love this piece is because it's deeply in the line of his love of Shakespeare. Obviously, Beatrice and Benedict, Much Ado About Nothing, we've all seen the movie. I think there's a play. But what's great about it is that the music really kind of embodies the argumentative witticisms, the zingers between the two of them. And you'll hear it especially in the allegro section, the fast section, when these themes, like you'll have something in the first violins, and then the clarinet will respond, and then there's a random chord in the middle of the woodwinds, and it just keeps on going back and forth in this kind of argumentative style. And that really embodies their whole relationship. And then somehow it comes together and culminates into something fantastic. So it's a really exciting piece in that way.
Gene, I brought in a CD where I've taken some snapshots of the music to play, and I thought I would play just a little bit. Let's see if we have time, at least the opening. Stop there. Of course,
and then there's a chord right there.
Yeah. I loved how the way you described it in our interview the other day about how it being a little bit like fencing. It's a little bit of
yeah. There's a lot of parrying and thrusting and
yeah.
But it's all verbal, and in this case, it's musical.
And you said that one part, a chord just sticks you in the eye.
Oh yeah. There's a couple of those. Be careful. Eye guards, glasses are good.
There's also in this overture a really another big moment that's a little bit later that's more like a swashbuckling kind of sound to it. Let's see if I've got myself queued up here. Quite a workout.
You just see Basil Rathbone now.
Yeah. Yeah, I often think of Richard Strauss as giving Hollywood the swashbuckling sound with Don Juan, but this is decades earlier.
Oh, yeah. They're actually very related. Of course, Korngold wrote the great, you know, Captain Blood and all those things. But they're all kind of related. It's this kind of riding, kind of driving feel to the rhythm. And it has this incredible propulsive quality to it that I just love. It's so Berlioz, too. If you want to see something great, watch online or wherever you can, a video of Charles Munch with Boston do it. Boy, oh boy. I wouldn't want to be near that baton. You'd really get run through.
The next piece on the program takes us into a completely different world musically and psychologically. Berlioz is of the 19th century. That's romanticism. That's all about expressing your emotions, and everything's hot-blooded. But by the time we get to Dmitri Shostakovich, it's much more about an expression of psychological states and the political situations to some extent, too.
Well, I think, when was the last time you did a Shostakovich symphony? Probably sometime recently.
Last season, the sixth was done a season or
great
so
symphony.
Ago.
Well, Shostakovich is famous. He lived, in the Soviet Union under Stalin for much of his life, and then once Stalin passed away, he had about 22 years without Stalin. A lot of his early works are really kind of political, hidden statements that were disguised as something or other. For example, the Fifth Symphony ends with the famous D major finale. It's supposed to be kind of victorious. Bernstein did it double the tempo that Shostakovich actually wrote. But when you do it the tempo that Shostakovich wrote, which is very slow, it's kind of like, you will be happy, you will be happy, and you're being just hammered over the head with it. But it's really kind of a serious problem, because in that time, you could not speak your mind. And so to write a piece that seems victorious and jubilant, but really, if you perform it right, can sound downright atrocious. Not in a kind of qualitative sense, but because it can feel like you're being dragged through an experience. And that's the kind of the mid and early part of Shostakovich. Once he really became kind of the grandfather of Soviet composition, he had all the titles, he had incredible access to automobiles and housing, and I mean, he was set. So what he was dealing with when he wrote this piece was really his own mortality, actually, more than the political situation, because he basically kind of, he became so important a person that you couldn't ignore him anymore, and you couldn't censor him too much. They did anyways, but so this violin concerto, which was his last concerto, and written, of course, for the great David Oistrakh, is a statement of one's, or coming, questioning of one's mortality, and how do you fight it? How do you come to grips with it? And in the context of his experience as a citizen of the Soviet Union. So there is also this horn solo part that you'll hear coming back all the time throughout the piece. And Irina Shostakovich, the last wife of Shostakovich, actually told our soloist a story just last month that this horn solo actually is supposed to be a musical evocation of Stalin himself, which is quite a serious thing to say, especially to someone who lived through that kind of fear and terror and knowing what a homicidal maniac he really was. So to say that the horn part is kind of Stalinist is an understatement. And what's interesting, the most interesting, for example, is at the end of the second movement, it's gorgeous. It's really beautiful. It's very tonal, and it sounds so lush. And that's why it's so bizarre, because it's still supposed to be this portrait of Stalin, but it's almost like a memory that's been forced to be beautiful. And there are all these slightly wrong notes here and there within this context of incredible magisterial beauty. So it's a very interesting piece. Mm.
I actually have that passage on the CD if you want me to cue ahead to it. Faded out, sorry.
The very last three notes that he plays, it's all very, very nasal. And it's just, it's kind of this weird caricature, but not quite a caricature. It's a fabulous, fabulous moment. I hope we do it well and give you something to take home. It's really quite an amazing piece. It's not everyone's cup of tea. You're allowed to dislike it. But I think that if you can see also in the last movement, what's interesting is that it's kind of a rollick. It's a sarcastic but humorous rondo. Rondo meaning that the themes continually come back. And you never know exactly how it's going to come back. And he's always kind of slapping you around because you're never sure, oh, is it now? No, it's not now. Oh, it's now. Okay. Oh, it's over. And then you're moving on to the next thing. And it's really, it's kind of like Haydn. You wouldn't necessarily put Haydn and Shostakovich in the same sentence most of the time, but actually it's a very common procedure to play with your expectations. You'll never know where you are. I know where we are, but you won't know where
we are. I have a little bit of that finale too, if you
Let's
want
hear
to
it.
Play that. Our soloist obviously is going to have not only a lot of fun, I'm sure he has a lot of fun playing it, but he's busy a lot of the time. He is front and center playing a lot of the material.
Yeah, he's going to be very busy tonight. Actually, what's interesting is that when Shostakovich first started working on this piece, he actually had a completely different idea. The different idea was that this violin wouldn't enter for 130 bars, and the orchestra had this huge exposition that was going to be grand and had triple woodwinds and great big fanfare. And then he just scratched the whole thing and started over, and the violin starts in the third bar. which is just, I mean, completely different concept. And if you hear the 10th symphony, they both have this kind of grinding beginning, where it's just kind of winding through tonalities, and you're not totally certain where you're going. And that kind of ambivalence about being in a key is, I think, part of the questioning nature of that first moment. Mm.
César Franck's Symphony in D minor is in the second half of the program. And, oh, by the way, I meant to ask you, is this your first concert conducting the Shostakovich concerto?
Yeah, this is actually my first performance. It's actually Mikhail's first performance, and it's the Oregon Symphony's first performance. So
yeah,
we're all new to it.
Franck D minor is a little bit different matter, though.
Warhorse.
You already have several performances under your belt.
Certainly.
And this symphony, Franck's one and only, and a rarity for that composer, who was primarily an organist, Belgian-born, then went to Paris, taught music and had kind of a small circle of admirers. But he sounds to me like he was something of an outsider. He wasn't quite entrenched in the musical scene. Certainly the instrumental music didn't quite get the same respect that the operas did in Paris at that time.
Oh, definitely. I mean, opera in Paris was the vogue, and symphonic music really didn't gain traction. I mean, Berlioz tried. There was a conductor in the 1830s who brought all the Beethoven symphonies, which was a novelty at the time. But symphonic music, really, they weren't interested. They're French. They wanted to see the ballet. They wanted to see the girls with the tutus, and that was, you know. Oh, by the way, ballets in French operas are generally in the second act because everyone was late. No, this is true. So you never put the ballet in the second act because all the wealthy gentlemen would be very upset that they missed it. Then Wagner came and he wrote Tannhäuser's Paris version and put the Bacchanal right after the overture and made a lot of people unhappy. In any case, back to Franck.
Back to Franck.
Franck and Wagner actually have a lot in common. What's interesting about the symphony is that it's very Wagnerian in some moments, and then suddenly it sounds very French. And it seems to be that a lot of the loudest moments sound very German, and the lightest moments sound very French. So see if we can really kind of evoke that lightness of French music, and then suddenly the massive organ quality in the louder dynamics.
Difficult for me to decide what to have us listen to from the CD, the opening three-note motif, just to establish that, or maybe one of the fortissimo sections of the first movement.
Why don't we do a little bit of both?
Okay. Just to give you the theme.
What you'll notice right away is that he uses certain instruments like an organist. So you have the basses and the cellos starting the opening, and it sounds like pedals. And then suddenly in the middle, you have the woodwinds come in, and that's like he's pulling out the oboe and bassoon stop on the organ. And that's how he kind of orchestrates his entire piece. And he does this. It's just one block of sound, and then he moves to the next registration, and then he moves to the next one. It's very interesting. Anton Bruckner, who was also an organist, he kind of composed in the same way, but his colors were slightly different.
There weren't very many French symphonies at this point. Saint-Saëns had written his organ symphony, and there might be others that are now forgotten. But so the Franck D minor really stands out from the 1880s in France as one of the examples of a new direction that French composers were trying to take at that time.
Yeah, it didn't really catch on. There were a couple symphonies that were written that are really fantastic. The Franck, the Chanson, actually, in B-flat, the famous Saint-Saëns organ symphony, where he actually uses an organ. There were some others by Eduardo Lalo, and we don't really hear them anymore. And I don't know if there's a good reason why we don't play them, but they're just kind of not in vogue.
Gene, we have just about a minute, and there's one story that I want you to share about the Franck, and that is the reaction by the audience at the time of what seems completely innocuous now, the use of a particular instrument in the second movement, the English horn. What was the big deal?
So tell me which Beethoven symphony has an English horn. That's right, none. So when you put an English horn in a symphony, people were scandalized, saying, well, that's not an academic proper symphonic instrument. Which is strange because, you know, Wagner had already started using English horn all the time. It's in Tristan and Isolde. Even Berlioz, actually, in his famous Symphonie Fantastique, uses an English horn, and it's huge. It's a huge solo. But for some reason, they kind of forgot that, and then 50 years later, everyone was surprised. They forgot their history. But in any case, when he put this English horn in, I guess it's just the novelty of it brought the critics, you know, rage on. But to our modern sensibilities, it's just a lovely sound, and I hope you enjoy it. We have a wonderful English horn player tonight, so I think it'll be a great show.
Yeah, and it's really going to rattle the rafters by the end of the piece, certainly. Eugene Tzigane, our guest conductor tonight. I'm John Pitman. Thank you for joining us.
Thanks very much. See you in a little bit.